I first met Jen Christensen when she took one of my classes toward the end of her first year at Butler. I think it was 1991, perhaps. I looked in my grade book earlier today before I came over here. And from the moment that she stepped foot on this campus, Jen was a leader. She participated in several organizations on campus, and she made a difference. And she was a student that a lot of other students followed. She was an inspiration to them. And so when she graduated and she said that she wanted to go into TV but didn't want to be in front of the camera, but instead wanted to do all the behind-the-scenes work, I just assumed that it would be just a matter of time before she was working at the network. And that is just about what Jen is doing now. She is a documentary producer for CNN. She's interviewed the likes of Congressman John Lewis, Jimmy Carter, President Bush, President Clinton, Madeleine Albright. She's traveled all around the country, visiting the Middle East, wearing a bulletproof vest and a gas mask when she was working on a CNN documentary about the intersection of religion and public policy and politics. Jen graduated from Butler with a radio TV degree back in 1994. She studied at the London School of Economics. She's a past board member of the Butler Alumni Association and was the featured speaker for the Schrott Lecture Series a few years ago, where she had the honor of being the first person to ever drop an F-bomb during the Schrott Lecture Series, one that anyone who went to that lecture still remembers to this day. It was quite the moment. And then finally, President Danko asked Jen to speak during his State of the University address last fall. Jen worked her way up. She was a producer for TV stations in Charlotte, Lexington, and right here in Indianapolis before going to work for CNN. And one of the best parts about being a friend of Jen's is that she sends you Christmas cards every year with her cat wearing various outfits and posed in all sorts of various things too. So that's also one of the benefits of being an FOJ or friend of Jen. But Jen is going to be speaking to us tonight about diversity in the media. It's not just enough for the media to be more diverse in the newsroom, but the types of stories that are coming out of the newsroom need to be more diverse too. And so Jen's going to be speaking about that. And at the end of her presentation, we would love to have questions from you. And we'll be going around the room with the microphone. And please ask Jen anything that you would want, not just about her topic for tonight, but about her career, about newsrooms, about CNN. It is definitely an interesting time to be working in the news these days. CNN is not the enemy of the people, as some people believe it to be, but you can definitely ask Jen anything you want. So without further ado, Jen Christensen.
Very bad. So nothing changes in Scott world. You're so bad. Unfortunately, the cat we have now does not wear costumes, so you will not be seeing him, but it is hopefully my sign of leadership skills that I can get an animal like that into a costume. Of course, I'm really honored to be here, and thank you, Scott, for that kind introduction. Spending time in your class has always been a joy, and knowing you afterwards has been an even greater joy. And thank you, too, to Christine, who's always such a huge help in my life and is a good friend as well, and is also a wonderful inspiration. There are so many great people here. We're so lucky to have such wonderful professors here. I'm sure you all have experienced some fabulous times here. So as Scott mentioned, I went to Butler, and I am not a PowerPoint person, so please forgive me. I know you all learned this in kindergarten, but this is new technology for me. So I wanted to show you the embarrassing proof that I went to Butler, because it is embarrassing. So you can see like acid wash jeans were really big. That was in Resco down there on the corner, terrifying. My haircut was inspired by Duran Duran, favorites of mine. Do you all know Duran Duran? You know, on the oldies station, right? So there's that. That's my roommate, Talithia. And then that's in Schwitzer Hall. So it wasn't like that big, terrible, you know, empty space over there with the big dirt piles. You know, it was this un-air-conditioned, kind of horrible dorm, but a wonderful place that built community, right? So that's what that looked like. Up there, that long skirt. Anyway, it was in the 90s, which was probably a time we never want to go back to in terms of fashion, at least. But it was great to get to actually be here at Butler. Lots of exciting things were happening here in Indianapolis and here on the campus. I currently now wear two hats. This is a terrible picture. I don't know why I picked that. But I am a producer at CNN and an editor as well. I work at both CNN on the cable side, and then I work on the digital side as well. As a producer and editor, I help guide the medical health and wellness unit, and apparently I'm the enemy of the American people, according to our president. There we go. So we've been dealing with a lot of that lately, and I'm sure you all have seen a lot of that, and it's a whole new atmosphere to get to work in, right? Because while we've had presidents who've disliked us strongly, I've never really had anyone tweet about us in quite the fashion. So as Scott said, it's an interesting time to be a journalist, for sure. I was joking, the only time anyone has ever called me the enemy of the people is my current cat, when I don't feed him enough wet food. So there you go, Ringo Starr, the presidential advisor. So the more glamorous hat that I wear, I'm an NLGJA president, and NLGJA is the Association of LGBTQ Journalists. We've been around for about 26 years, and as a national board president, I do whatever I can to try to help advocate for fair and accurate coverage of the LGBTQ community. What we do specifically is we work behind the scenes in newsrooms. We work journalist to journalist. So rather than trying to embarrass people about their inaccurate coverage of the community, we talk to them directly, and we talk to them peer-to-peer and say, you know, if you're here to try to get things right, here's why you don't use the word homosexual, because homosexual is a term that offends people because it's politically loaded. We spend a lot of time doing something with the Rapid Response Task Force, which is something that tries to address poor coverage in the community. A lot of the poor coverage we see lately is of transgender people. So we spend a lot of time trying to educate people about the appropriate terms to use so that people aren't inadvertently offending people. Most of the time, journalists don't mean to get the story wrong. Most of the time, they don't try to get the story wrong and that they would be offending somebody. Instead, really, what they're trying to do is trying to keep up with what's going on. So we try to do that. NLGJA also is a professional association, so we have a convention so people can network and work behind the scenes together to get to know each other and work their way up. We have student scholarships, so if anyone needs any money, and you all are attending Butler, so I think you might, please see me. We are welcoming of, you don't have to be LGBT or Q to be a member, nor do you have to be LGBTQ to get a scholarship either. So please come up to me afterwards, and I'm happy to tell you more about that. Let's see. So with my job at CNN, I'm sure you all know what producers do, right? Do people have a sense of what that is? And for those who don't, producers are the people who Okay, so I work with all these people. So there's Christiane Amanpour. So like when the Queen is giving her CBE, her big honor, the British honor, or when Anderson's on the front of the magazine covers, or you know, Dr. Gupta's performing brain surgery. Yeah, he performs brain surgery in his spare time. It's amazing. And then Don Lemon, I have no idea what Don Lemon's doing there. But while they're doing those things, usually I'm the one who's gathering the information and doing the research and trying to understand what the stories are. And, you know, because they do a lot of this kind of stuff, you know, they don't have a lot of time to do the gathering of the information. So that's what I get to do when I work on the TV side of things. It's a lot of fun, and it, you know, we don't get the magazine covers, but it certainly is an exciting thing to get to do if you want to be a journalist and do good journalism. And you know, it has sent me all over the world, as Scott had mentioned, so that was really nice. When we got the Peabody, I got on the front page of my local newspaper. My mom was really excited about that on my birthday. I got to throw out the first pitch at the Phillies game last year. That's kind of cool because of the NLGJ president. I got to meet Alice Waters, who's an amazing chef. We covered Katrina, which was fascinating. In December, we got a selfie with the Dalai Lama. I mean, come on, it's a selfie with the Dalai Lama. When we interviewed him, too. And then, you know, and Scott said I wore a bulletproof vest. We got to interview, those were Hamas terrorists. They were terrorist fighters. And Holly, my spouse, who's in the audience, hates when I tell this story, but they really did. I was with Chris John, put bags on our heads, and they drove us all over, and so we wouldn't know where people were. And you know, it was like it was kind of like in the movies. You know, it was exactly as scary as you would think. But when we got there, it was kind of funny. They, you know, in Middle Eastern tradition, it's only polite to offer people something to drink and something to eat when you get there. So they had tang and cookies. So these men in these scary masks with these big weapons were offering us tang and cookies before they were interviewing with us. The contrast was kind of funny. So anyway, so my job's pretty cool. Oh, and then the one that my mom always likes is I got to be on Times Square on a billboard when they interviewed me for a conversation about NLGJ. So for those of you who you know don't think being a producer is glamorous and who only want to be on air, let me tell you, there are amazing opportunities if you want to be somebody off camera. It's one of the coolest jobs in the world. Okay, so as Scott said, I was a student here, and I thought I would include some embarrassing pictures from when I was here. That's Christine. Look at Christine. And look at Scott. I think Scott was sleeping in the C Club. Do we still have a C Club? I don't know why he was sleeping, eating a pizza in the C Club. Unfortunately, that was my only picture of Scott, so there you go. And then we used to have a radio station, WAJC, so Scott bravely put me on the air for an hour live doing interviews with actually some pretty big people who would come to town doing live interviews on radio. That was probably not a good idea. This is the lawyer for Roe v. Wade. We built this set. We brought the Marines in, which was so cool, and we built this big set for WTBU. And then we had this half-hour-long program called Newsline, Indiana. We even had business cards, where we got to talk to people and do in-depth interviews. So Butler was an amazing place that even as undergrads, we got to do this incredible amount of professional work. It really was a great education, and this stuff is what really prepared me for the next stage of my life, right? I don't know what's next. Okay, so while the topic was a title that Scott picked for me, it is a topic that is, of course, near and dear to my heart since I wear those two hats, the NLGJ hat and the newsroom hat. And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about why diversity is what it is and why it's important in the newsroom. And I thought I would show you one of the greatest debates we have had this year in the newsroom. Okay, are you guys ready? All right, now the audio, please, is Richard Miles around? Okay, I did terrible in that class and my audio is terrible, but I think most of you have probably seen this, so let me see if it works. This is the great newsroom debate of 2017. Let's see, oh, please work. Oh, shoot, all right. What do I need to do to make it work? Oh, here we go. All right, the great newsroom debate of 2017. No, shoot. Oh, come on. This is good. Oh, what do I need to do, guys? Okay. Oh, there we go. All right. Sorry. Thank you.
One Halftime Show.
How do I turn that? All right, you probably all saw this, right? I bet you thought I was going to talk about the president, right? The debate. All right. So, all right. I want you guys to think about this, right? This is the most watched Super Bowl halftime show in history. I don't know when people went to the bathroom. So this is a far cry from the 1989 show where Elvis performed magic tricks. I am not making that up. I've learned so much doing the speech. The assignment I have for you, because I don't want y'all to fall asleep and you're kind of quiet, is I want you to maybe turn to your neighbors and talk about, pretend, that you were in a newsroom, okay? And if you were in a newsroom, and you were, I'm so sorry, you were working on Super Bowl Sunday, so you must have done something wrong to make the manager very angry. But if you're going to do this, I want you to come up with a headline, and I want you to come up with a story about what it is that you just saw, okay? So I'm just going to give you just a couple minutes, all right? Talk with each other. Come on. Anyone want to tell me one of their headlines? Oh, come on, somebody's got to be brave. There's a prize for whoever gives me a headline. Yes, sir.
A leap of faith with Lady Gaga.
Oh, nice. Do you want a hat? Yes, ma'am.
Lady Gaga starts with LGBTQ song.
Nice. Okay. All right. Anyone else?
I was going to say, like, Lady Gaga rocks the stage in Super Bowl. I don't know the number. But, and then, like, the story would be about them.
Good. Oh, you had Scott's class, didn't you? Oh. That's good. Okay. Anyone else? Yes?
Like a lot of the songs were like some popular ones throughout her career, like you could show how like Lady Gaga can evolve through the years.
Cool. Very cool. Anyone have anything like totally radically different in their conversation from what you're all saying? Anyone? Yes, ma'am, in the back.
We don't have a headline, but we talked about like the drones. Like, it was the first time that that many drones that were pre-programmed were used for performance.
All that cool technology coming together, and that's cool. Yeah, nice. Anyone else who have something a little bit different? Okay. Well, let's take a look at what the national press came up with, because there's, as you can imagine, a wide variety, right? So here's the Washington Post. So Lady Gaga avoids politics at Super Bowl halftime show, flies off roof of stadium. So, you know, when you're writing headlines, you know, you're trying to get people's attention, right? So Lady Gaga, you all know about SEO. It's very important to use big terms like that so people find it in search. But then they talk about how she avoided politics. Interesting. And then she flies off the roof of the stadium. Nothing about the drones, nothing about anything else. And, you know, for the Washington Post that sees a lot of things through the lens of politics, you could see potentially where they didn't think that this was a political speech. They've written a lot about, I was looking at their coverage in the past, they've written about her support of Hillary Clinton. They wrote about her, she had a protest outside of Trump Tower. She brought a garbage truck and loved Trump's hate sign and stood in front of Trump Tower, which is kind of fun. So they've seen more direct political action than what she did at the Super Bowl. Let's see. So there's another one. This is from the New York Times. Lady Gaga at the Super Bowl. No controversy, lots of glitter. So that was kind of cute. You know, they in the past have written a lot about her fashion sense. They write a lot about her style. That's the wonderful ick meat dress. So that was her controversy. I know, Scott, we were talking about that earlier. So they've written about her as an outrageous performance artist. So you could see kind of where they were going with that. The Guardian, you know, that's a nice liberal, political British publication. Lady Gaga's Super Bowl performance, heavy on the hits, like you guys said, light on the politics. So we see a theme that they didn't think that this was political. The Guardian, over the years, I was looking at their coverage. They've talked about her support for Hillary Clinton. They've talked about some of her more radical kind of protests on behalf of animal rights, her support to try to help fight against bullying. They even figured out where that meat came from and what happened to it on the meat dress, which I thought was fascinating. It became jerky, in case anyone's wondering. So let's check what my guys did. We went with an opinion piece. I didn't know there was an opinion piece about the Super Bowl, but that there's an opinion about everything. A Lady Gaga, the perfect reflection of Trump, which I think is interesting. If you read the piece, it's just talking about how he's an outrageous kind of personality, and so is she, and she embodies the era, and interesting. But again, notice this is all kind of different, right? Let's see. Breitbart, so we're going to go to the conservative press. Lady Gaga avoids politics during Super Bowl halftime show. So again, it's interesting that you all picked up on the LGBTQ rights, but Breitbart didn't. Last year they wrote about Beyonce at the Super Bowl, and boy, did they write like an angry article about Beyonce, and you know who they talked at length about how she dressed like somebody from the Black Power movement of the '60s, and but it's interesting that they absented this whole conversation from this talk about Lady Gaga. So then there's, this is the Washington Times, which is also conservative. They also said that there was no political statement whatsoever within the context of this Super Bowl thing. It's interesting that depending on your perspective, you're gonna get this. Then let's look at the feminist press. I promise there are only a couple more. This is Bustle. Lady Gaga's halftime show was political no matter what stunts she did. So it's interesting, again, that from their frame of reference, they are really interested in the feminist statement that she was making. They spoke at length about the opening with the song about This Land Is Your Land. They wrote about the LGBTQ rights. They were on target and focused about politics as opposed to the acrobatics of it. Let's do this one. The Advocate, an LGBTQ magazine, of course, was talking about the subversive ways that Lady Gaga was trying to talk about the Super Bowl and politics. Teen Vogue, a good feminist article as well, also talking about This Land Is Your Land. I don't know if you all know this, you probably do, but This Land Is Your Land, while a nice patriotic song, is something that Woody Guthrie wrote in protest because while he was traveling around the country, as we know, during the Depression, they kept playing God Bless America, which is written by an immigrant who found, you know, a very good thing here, whereas Woody Guthrie during the Depression saw just how challenged people were, poor people were being treated unfairly during the Depression. So he wrote this amazing, powerful protest song. And then one of the verses, I don't know if you've been to any protests lately against the government, but people have been singing it lately, and they've been singing this verse. Let's see if I have it. It's about President Trump's father. President Trump's father was a property owner, and because of some of the things that he was doing, he wasn't allowing African-American people to live in his complex. So here is the line that they wrote, he wrote about President Trump. So Lady Gaga, by choosing God Bless America and This Land Is Your Land, putting them together, that made a political statement, right? But again, the conservative press didn't really think so. There were some press that also looked at Twitter, because Twitter reacted pretty strongly to this performance, as you can imagine. I just picked a couple that the feminist press picked. I thought these were kind of funny. So you might want to look. I will not read them out loud, since this was your former governor. But there's some interesting protests there, right? So obviously, some people really did feel strongly that this was a political act. This wasn't just entertainment. And then this is my favorite, and I promise this is the last one. apparently, on the internet, there were a number of people having long conversations about Lady Gaga being satanic. Come on, let's think about this. They thought she was performing a rite of Satan. Isn't that amazing? No one else thinks, okay, I thought that was kind of incredible. I would never have gone there. But anyway, I just use this as an example, a really simple example that probably won't live on in history compared to a lot of other important stories of our day. But it's an example where we see that newsroom diversity, perspectives that are wildly different in the Breitbart newsroom as opposed to my newsroom, as opposed to the Washington Post, they all see the same exact thing, but yet they come up with a whole different interpretation of what that is. So this is my example to say, hey, I think it's really important that in newsrooms we have a diverse group of perspectives and ideas and people, because we all kind of interpret reality differently. And hopefully news gets to facts, not alternative facts, but real facts. The Wall Street Journal had this really nice article about what the press should be doing in the era of President Trump. And let me just show that. This is what they said facts were, that are ascertainable through honest, open-minded, and diligent reporting, that truth is attainable by laying fact upon fact, much like the construction of a cathedral, and that truth is not merely in the eye of the beholder. Right? So while the eye of the beholder is really, really, really important, we have to be able to get to the nut of what is going on around us. And then that's the great thing that journalism does, is filters it all together and comes up with this story that tells us what's going on in this world. There have been problems in the past because there wasn't diversity in the newsroom and people weren't seeing what was going on around them. Let me see. Oh. Alternative facts. I love this. I just love that that's now part of our conversation. So as journalists, you know, one of the things that we are charged with doing is separating truth from lies, even when powerful people are telling us that we're wrong and insist that there's absolutely no such thing, or they call us fake, or, you know, that they intimidate us. Our job is still to try to give you the truth, whatever that might be, of what's going on. And sometimes we get it right, and sometimes we get it wrong. But most of the time, we are trying our best to get it right. So I think it's interesting that the conservative press may have been deliberately obtuse, may have been looking for something else. Maybe they expected Beyonce, but they got Lady Gaga, who, for people like me, was really making an important political statement. People from all over the world were watching a football game, and yet they were hearing about LGBTQ rights. That, to me, is a pretty powerful statement. I saw this the other day, and I thought this was kind of funny. Because sometimes that's what the politicians would like us to see, right? They don't want us to see the fire that's coming to kill us. They just want us to blame some other, you know, system for letting us down. And they want us to sit there still drinking our coffee, right? But a journalist's job is to kind of rouse you out of that and to try to see the world for what it is, I hope. I think the other thing that might be happening here with not understanding what was happening at the Super Bowl is that people, well, Billboard said it best, the nation that is so divided, people assume that political statements need to offend, but you also need people who help normalize previously stigmatized groups, right? So LGBTQ people, hopefully, were previously stigmatized, although we can talk about hate crimes and all the terrible things that still happen to the community. But in Lady Gaga doing something so radical by doing something in such a beautiful and subtle way, really, maybe she's helping change reality. Maybe she's trying to help us see that. And again, a journalist's job is to try to pick up on it in real time and point that out. So let me give you a local news example of what's going on when we do have diversity in a newsroom and why diverse opinions and people from different communities matter, okay? So when I first started here in my profession, I was lucky enough to have an internship at Fox 59 down the street. And that internship turned into a full-time job, which was incredible. What also was incredible was they put me in charge of the assignment desk. And the assignment desk, at the time, you know, it was on the weekends. So I had no managers to be able to check my news instincts. I had no one to tell me whether or not I was right or wrong about what stories were important and what we were covering. So it was a little scary for a new student to be into this world, but it seemed to work. And it was also scary because we didn't have the internet much then. We were relying on scanners and radio and, you know, people who were just out and about telling us what was going on. We would get faxes. I don't even think I know how to use a fax machine anymore. But this was like a very different world. And at the time, when I was here in the 90s, there was a huge crack epidemic going on. So while there was a big crack epidemic, there was a slew of homicides. We had so many homicides every day, and it was new for the city to experience that. We also had police corruption scandals, a mayor corruption scandal, and we had serial killers. I mean, it was an intense kind of baptism by fire. What is this? Oh, there we go. Baptism by fire. The first thing I want to show you is a story that we did. We didn't get it because somebody sent us a press release. We didn't get it because we read it in the newspaper, like we did do a lot of other stories. Instead, what happened was we had two people who had gone to church. And while they were at church, they heard, as you know, good churches do, about this experience that somebody in the neighborhood had had. And this was a man who had been terribly beaten by the police. And this man, this poor man, was just eating in a restaurant. I don't know exactly how it started, but as he was leaving, the police literally beat him bloody on the sidewalk. And so when he went to go and complain about that, what the police said was, oh, you just tripped and fell when you left the restaurant. You know, we've all heard these kind of horrible stories, right? So Mr. Sears, is his name, Sears went to his neighborhood and said, please come and help me protest. I want you to come down to the police station. I think it was at, is this like 34th in Illinois, maybe around there? And they gathered peacefully. People from the neighborhood came out, hung out outside the police station, had protest signs, just like you would see today, right? And they were peaceful. They weren't doing anything wrong. They were just saying, please, please pay attention. The police department has treated this man terribly, and all hell broke loose. The police, well, they brought out... They peppered sprayed the crowd. They put on riot gear. They brought out big armored vehicles. They had dogs. It was like a classic, horrible, horrible thing. But we were there early in large part because we had two African-American photographers who heard about it at church. So these two photographers were good, and they came to us and told us something's going down in the neighborhood. And you know, I was listening to the scanner, I was paying attention to the radio, but the police were not talking about this. So had we not had these guys who had gotten up early on a Sunday morning, gone to church, had they not been a part of the community, we probably would have heard about it when the riot police were out there, but we got there so much earlier, and we got the real truth of the story because we were there at the beginning. And we could see how people were being treated, and it was not good. Because, you know, the authority, of course, wanted us to believe everything's fine, this man deserved it, but because we had diversity in our newsroom and a connection, we were able to get it.
This unrest started after allegations of police brutality during an arrest in the neighborhood earlier this week.
Those allegations sparked a protest demonstration last night that set the stage for the violence and tension that has followed. The protest last night started loudly, but peacefully. The crowd gathering around the IPD substation at 42nd and College, then moving south to the scene of the alleged police beating at 38th Street. That's where the protest turned ugly. Members of the crowd started taunting police, and efforts to calm the situation quickly failed. IPD began an overwhelming show of force. Donning riot gear and calling more than 100 units to the area. Officers used tear gas to disperse the crowd and arrested those who would not step aside.
I'm not resisting.
The confrontation became most tense when bottles and bricks filled the air, leaving a trail of victims caught in the middle.
A couple people just started yelling at me, making racial comments that I was white or something. Started throwing bricks at my car, and I was like headed down here.
He's a photographer.
I saw the cop cars.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm a little shaken up.
The situation died down slowly through the night as city leaders arrived and started hearing complaints that continue echoing tonight.
Why are you running away, Mr. Mayor? Citizens don't deserve a response to the question.
So it's a pretty typical kind of story, right? So violence is happening in a neighborhood. Police are behaving in the way that you want them to behave. It's not completely captured in this. There's another story that we did later on that in the broadcast that I wasn't able to capture fully, but it was a family that lived in the middle of these experiences, and this family was was stuck. You know, they were on their porches, and the police were coming up to the porch and tear gassing them. They were spraying pepper spray on them. There was a pregnant lady sitting on the porch, and the police were doing this. And we were able to, because we were there early, and because we cared deeply about this, and because we weren't listening to the police, who at the time the police chief resigned, but who was saying, oh, nothing's going on here. No, no, we didn't do anything. You know, because we had somebody in the newsroom who was passionate about this, we were able to cover this, and we were able to cover the truth of what was going on. And what was really good, too, was there was this reporter, Russ McQuaid, is he still here? So Russ had covered some of these experiences in this neighborhood before. And Russ was great because he knew this family and showed the kind of compassion that I would hope people would have. Because he said, you know, what are these folks supposed to do? They want a safe neighborhood, they want a good neighborhood, and yet the people who are supposed to be protecting them aren't treating them very well. It was because he had spent quality time with folks, because he was spending time with people who lived in the neighborhood, he was able to get at the truth of what has happened. Let me go. Oh, no, no, really, go away. Oh. All right, sorry. So let me go back here. So this is like what we're supposed to be doing, right? So we are, I don't know why I can't get there. No, I can redesign it for you. No, slideshow, there we go. Not from the beginning, from the current slide. There we go. All right, so SPJ, which is wonderfully based here, tells us that we are supposed to boldly tell the story of the diversity and the magnitude of human experience. Seek sources whose voices we seldom hear. Again, because we had a diverse staff, we were able to tell this story. So diversity isn't always something that the EEOC checks, right? So you can be diverse because you come from a class that isn't the dominant class in the newsroom, or you could be somebody who's has a religious upbringing that's different than everyone else. In this case, one more story from Fox 59. We had an anchor who's no longer there, I know, who was going to a bar, and he saw these posters of these missing men. Now, unfortunately, this anchor had this in his contract. It's called the Morals Clause. And so the Morals Clause, he was a gay man, but he couldn't come out. This is the mid-90s. He couldn't come out because the management had told him it would be in violation of the morals of the community. We have been told at NLGJA there are still several members who have this as part of their contract. So if you're ever wondering why not all gay people come out who are on the air, it's because they're considered kind of the equivalent of, what does it say? We had one that said it was a drunk driver. So somebody who is violating the morals of the community, that's why they couldn't come out. So this anchor saw this poster at a gay bar, couldn't tell our management, but said, I think there's a story here. There are a bunch of missing men, and it seems like something is going on. So fortunately, he was able to talk to a woman who was straight, who was married, and she was able to go to the news director and say, hey, look at these missing posters. I won't tell you how I got them, but I think this is a story. So can we do this? And he said, sure. So fortunately, we were able to spend some quality time digging into a story that same year that really, I think, again, because of this diversity, because somebody was open to seeing something in the world, because he was at a place where not everyone in the newsroom was going to, we were able to catch on to a story that even the police weren't paying attention to at the time. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be picking on the police, but the police at the time weren't our best friends. So what we found with a lot of poking and prodding was, and maybe some of you all are familiar with this story, is that there was a horrible serial killer preying upon young McGay men in Indianapolis. His name was Herbert Baumeister. Have you guys ever heard of him? Have you ever heard of him? Okay, so this is really freaky. So he lived up in Carmel. He was a Boy Scout leader. He was a business owner. He was a well-respected man in the community. And from what we understand, he had been doing this for decades. So when somebody actually got to escape, there were some interesting circumstances. He escaped. His boyfriend at the time was killed. He went to tell police about it. And the police said that they didn't actually believe him. They said, oh, you're kind. They just disappear all the time. You're kind. You know, so it was a lot of those kind of conversations. But we took this guy seriously. We took the people who were experiencing terrible pain, who were missing their loved ones, seriously. So we kept poking and we kept poking. Actually, we had to go to a leather bar. I won't talk about it at length, but it was really funny that I got paid to sit at a leather bar for work. It was interesting. I learned a lot then too. But because we asked the right questions and because we had somebody who was diverse and different from everyone else asking us to ask these questions, we were able to break a pretty big story. The police, actually this man was married, and finally when she filed for divorce, they were able to go into this beautiful house. I hear it's on the Haunted Mansion tour. Scary. The police were able to go in there. They dug in the backyard and they found the remains of at least 12 people. They think he killed 30 people. So again, this serial killer was taking advantage of a community that was invisible, right? And because we had diversity in our newsroom, we were able to luck into a story that I hope helped save people's lives. I know that's a really heavy and horrible topic. I hope to God this doesn't happen these days. I hope the community feels comfortable enough here that this will never happen. But this is the beginning of my career. So it was a very interesting thing and a very interesting case to me that it was important to have different voices within the newsroom. Okay, I've talked a lot, so let's do another exercise, okay? So again, turn to the other person that you didn't get to talk to last time, and I want you to ask some questions, okay? All right, and Scott, you can talk to the wall. I don't know, I'm sorry. All right, so here are the questions I want you to ask yourself, all right? Are you diverse? What do you think diversity is? Would you consider yourself diverse, and what makes you diverse? What would diversity help in the newsroom, or any workplace for that matter? How could being in a diverse group help with communication? How could being in a diverse group be a challenge to communications? So take 5 minutes. Is that cool? Yes, ma'am.
I feel like each person is diverse depending on what context you put it in. So if you, like, I'm also diverse, but I'm not really diverse in my background to me, I look at that kind of thing similar to me. But if you talk to me,
diversity is dependent on your situation. Hat or pen or stylus? Anyone think that diversity would be something that, how would it help in a workplace, maybe even one that's not in a newsroom? Anyone have? Yes.
Well, I kind of answer like the last two questions together with the same answer, being that like with a diverse group, you get different experiences and you get different people that help you basically have different perspectives on communication, so you can bring different ideas together. But at the same time, if it's not utilized properly, it can also create a challenge where you have differing opinions that don't agree.
Interesting. And what happens with that challenge? What's a good way to kind of work around that, do you think?
Like, maybe even to expand on it a little bit, is like, if you don't have people that are willing to be open-minded about different ideas, then it brings that challenge. And just kind of working around it in the sense of it helps you respect other people's ideas if you can kind of overcome that challenge.
So overcome, but then also help amplify the message of somebody who may be a one in a newsroom of similar,
yeah,
or a workplace of similar. Good. That's good. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
I think another way to help, like, combat the challenge to communication, so like what you were talking about, is when you're in, especially in like a newsroom, you have a story where you can take the diverse viewpoint of maybe like the majority or the minority. And like we talked about before in the journalism ethics, if you always want to speak to the course of the minority, because that's going to challenge like prevailing like cultural norms or whatever, and that's the most important thing to do. So it's just like to keep in mind, like going into like your daily work, that like while we all have very different perspectives, like if this is the prevailing
That's good. That's really good. Do you think there's ever a time in which you don't have to get another side? Like if you're doing a story about, I don't know, Black Lives Matter, do you have to go and talk to the Klan?
That's what I think is especially interesting during like kind of political things. Like if I'm looking for myself right now, because when you talk about truth, sometimes the opposing side, it isn't true. And if your job is to report what is honest and good, then I don't think that there's a reason to hear the voice of something that's not right, that's not just.
And one is not the other, right? So one is a movement to empower a group of people that don't always have a voice, and one is maybe is a hate group that does terrible things. So they're not equivalent, right? So like, yeah. So if you're trying to manage truth, you're not necessarily getting truth by getting the one side and the other side.
It's like very obvious. Mm-hmm. Like you could do a story on the Ku Klux Klan or like whatever. Mm-hmm. If you're talking about Black Lives Matter movement.
Yeah.
It's one of the men.
You have a good ethics class. That's good. Anyone else? Anyone else? Is there another kind of diversity beyond just situational that is important that you think that may be underrepresented in certain areas? Well, I have an example. This is a friend of ours who worked at the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. I mean, she does count as a check-the-box EEOC minority because she's a woman in the newsroom, or was in the newsroom. She is a white woman of a certain age, but she had a background that made her diverse, that gave her one of the coolest and biggest stories of the time. That really encapsulated an important issue that was in Atlanta. Michelle grew up in an evangelical background, and in growing up in an evangelical faith, she was able to use the language that is really important to evangelicals to be able to talk to this woman here, Sadie Fields. Sadie Fields was this really influential Christian Coalition person in Georgia who had a lot of power, and she absolutely hated the media. I mean, she made Trump look like a CNN fan, you know? She really hated the media, and she particularly hated the newspaper, so she would never talk to anyone. But Michelle kept after her and said, I really think that you're an important person. You're a voice that we really need to understand. And she was able to use the language that she heard growing up to be able to talk the talk with Sadie Fields. And over time, Sadie Fields grew to trust her because as Michelle said, you know, Sadie was part of her tribe, as the language that she used. So because she understood her background, Sadie thought, even though she hates the media, she really thought that that Michelle was going to give her a fair shot, you know, and be able to hear her story. Well, it was quite the story, because not only was she powerful, but we come to find out, it was the first time we had ever found this out, that she believed so strongly in her faith and her understanding of what that faith was, that she had a real personal struggle within her own family. Her daughter, it turns out, happened to be gay. And her daughter, unfortunately, felt so put off by this woman who wanted to have the demons driven out of her, that she moved across the country. She changed her name. She became a Democrat. And the ultimate rebellion, she didn't work for Microsoft and she didn't work for The Gap. She went to work for Planned Parenthood. So she was a rebel in this woman's world. And it was an amazing profile in large part because it humanized Sadie Fields, this strong personality, and showed that there were these tensions that even though she believed strongly in her faith, it led her away from people in her own family. Michelle doesn't think that she would be able to have gotten that story. She wouldn't have been able to earn her trust had she not had that background and had been able to relate to Sadie in a human way. she sent me this quote, which I thought was really nice. It's so important for newsrooms to have people who can respectfully gain entry and trust without demographic groups of all kinds and tell their stories with respect and integrity. I don't think journalists can make anyone see common ground, but with diversity in newsrooms, the media has a better shot at depicting our shared humanity and can better avoid feeding stereotypes and existing bias. I thought that was pretty thoughtful and pretty interesting. And you know, what I wanted you guys to do is to kind of, I love Dr. Seuss, but I think, you know, as you enter into the workplace, the more you can be an authentic human being, the more you can bring yourself to that place, I think the better off you're going to be, especially in journalism, because in journalism, you know, we have to know a whole heck of a lot about a lot of things, and it's a really big time pressure to be able to get things done quickly. You have to have a depth of knowledge that other people may not have. You know, if you grew up Catholic, for instance, let's see, if you grew up Catholic, do you all know the name of what that body is? There's a specific weird name. Anyone? Anyone? Did anyone grow up Catholic? No? The Cardinals. And do you know who it is that helps the Pope govern? Anyone? Okay. It's the Curia. That's okay. All right. I'll skip the Catholic stuff. Okay. So if you know so much about the Pacers, you may know Paul George's shoe size, right? Can you believe that this is actually a story? I love that there's a whole blog about how big his feet are. Truly. And he has some of the smallest feet in all of the NBA. Does anyone know who has the smallest feet in the NBA? Anyone? Anyone? There's a prize. No? No? Really? I thought you guys would be basketball crazy. Okay. So it's a guy from the Celtics. He has a size 9. But again, if you know this kind of stuff, this is stuff that, I mean, you're probably not going to be in a locker room talking to a guy about a shoe size, I don't think. But, you know, this is a depth of knowledge that you can draw upon as you write stories, and as you write detailed stories. I'm sure your professors have talked to you about when you write, detail is your friend, right? So if you know something like that, that just kind of paints a better picture, right? I mean, again, maybe not the most important diversity, but something that does kind of get you to a different kind of story than somebody else, right? And even if you're, you know, specialty is interest in science fiction. Does anyone know who this guy is? Man. Come on. No? All right. No one? All right. Why am I the only Star Wars geek? Okay, so he's from Star Wars. He's in Return of the Jedi. He's in Jabba the Hutt's lair. He's only on the screen for a little bit, but if you're a Star Wars nerd, this is a big deal. And I have to tell you, Star Wars is one of those things that does incredibly well online, no matter what you write about it. So this little action figure guy is worth a lot of money because he was obscure and for whatever reason. So if you happen to know that, and you know somebody was digging around in their basement and they happened to find something valuable, your editor could send you to go check that out, right? And that would be a lot more fun than doing a lot of the other stories we get stuck doing. And speaking of topics that are big, if you want to know, so Star Wars, anything about Star Wars, if you want a specialty in this beat. I had a coworker, his name was Andy Siegel. I put his picture in here. So he always said that there are four things, I won't swear, but it is a little crude, four things that always do well online, and it is a little sexist, just so you know. So the story topics that always do well online, Andy Siegel. I won't say that first word, because I have a reputation now. Okay, tits, tots, pets, and priests. I swear, I know it's gross, it's horrible, it's sexist, but it's true. This guy has won the top awards in all of broadcasting covering these four topics, and these four topics do really, really well. So if you want just one thing that you come away with from this lecture is these are the topics you want to write about because your editors will love you. And Star Wars. So there we go. So this is, let me just skip ahead a little bit. So anyway, diversity comes in all fashions and forms. But I want to talk about specifically about ethnic diversity, racial diversity, gender diversity quickly. So the reason that we, in addition to telling a full picture, in addition to telling the full story, the reason that we need diversity in our newsrooms is because there's a deep dissatisfaction if you're not seeing yourself reflected in the news, right? So African Americans, I was looking this up, they read newspapers more, they listen to the news more, they follow news more online than any other group. It's about 7 in 10 people in the community read the news. So, but yet at the same time, African Americans and Latinos have a deep dissatisfaction with the news. It's a little bit hard to see, but it found that only 25% of African Americans and 33% of Hispanics said that the news media accurately portrays their communities. And nearly all Hispanics said that they actually had to turn to Spanish language programs to see that their community was reflected. You know, of course, the trouble is that a growing number of Hispanics don't speak Spanish. So where are they going to actually be able to get the news about the community that they care about? So we're doing them a disservice. Clearly, something is not really working, right? So a lot of the dissatisfaction about the way in which the news was covering the communities started officially in 1967. 1967 was a year when there were 159 riots, and these were devastating riots. People burned down whole neighborhoods. African Americans were being beat up and shot at and killed and tortured, not just by the police, but by roving gangs of young white people who hated the African American community. So when this was happening, the president said, "What in the world is going on? We are the United States. We're supposed to be welcoming of all. Something must be happening here." So he put together a commission, and it was called the Kerner Commission, and named for the guy who ran it. Those are the guys who did it. Oh, and there's one woman. So they put together this report, and a big part of this report was saying, not blaming the media, but they said that the media was not doing a great enough job trying to cover the community. So the Kerner report, let me see if I can get this up. So they said that the media essentially has failed to not just cover it adequately, but failed to analyze the problems that were underlying why there was violence in the community and why bad things were happening to people in those communities, right? So what they suggested was that maybe, just maybe, we need to encourage the newsrooms to be a bit more diverse. Because while African Americans were suffering from double the employment rate of white people, they had overcrowded schools and less funding, they weren't allowed to move out to the suburbs and some of the nicer neighborhoods because of redlining, and they were being harassed by the police, that this is what the newsrooms of the time looked like, right? So if you see, they're all white men, absolutely every one of them. And now, at the time, there were a few women in the newsroom, but usually there weren't any African Americans in the newsroom. I think it was 1%. And in terms of editors, it was 2%. So if you have absolutely no diversity and you don't spend a lot of time with people in a different community, you're not going to necessarily know about the stories that are impacting them, right? So you're not going to be able to tell the truth of what it is that's going on. So in 1967... now, things are different. There is a lot more diversity in the newsroom, but it's certainly not equal to what the population is. So racial minorities make up 37% of the population, and racial minorities will be the majority in 2040. But look at that. In newspapers, it was 4%, and it's gotten better. It's gone to 12 to 17%, but my God, it's 12 to 17%. Local news is better. But it's still 10 to 11%. Networks better, 23%. And then digital, the newer medium, has 27%. So it's still not equal to the population. And as that population grows, as our population becomes more diverse, we are not keeping up, right? So that's a significant problem. In the smaller newsrooms, this is an even bigger issue because smaller newsrooms are where we get the up-and-coming talent for the bigger networks. Most newspapers have zero reporters of color. Zero. In 1250, that's a lot of newspapers that are not reflective of their community, right? That's not good. And this is a long time since the 1960s. Newspapers did do something that was pretty cool. One of the programs that they did, in terms of deliberate hiring, in terms of forming associations in which there were talent pools, in which people could go out and reach populations that may not be in the J schools, may not have the education that you all got to have in the 60s, they went and did a program at the Tribune had called MetPro. And MetPro was essentially a play, it was like a better than an internship. So it was mentoring, it was an opportunity for people to get to meet people within the networks. My friend Lisa France, who's at CNN, was a Met Pro back in the day. But she said, you know, often she's the only one. And what happens is when you're the only one, your voice gets drowned out, right? People don't always hear you. And she said, well, she does a great job with it. She gets really tired having to advocate for one community all the time because no one else has her back, essentially. So what we've seen is that African Americans and Hispanics are dropping out of the newsroom at record rates, often because while people may be well-intentioned and people may think that they believe in diversity, folks are feeling isolated. People are not being heard. People are not being able to go up the ladder like they should, right? So I want to talk, well, let me go forward. And then this is also the problem, people in leadership positions. There isn't a lot of diversity up there. I was amazed by this number, and I double-checked it several different sources, but 90% of newsroom supervisors are white. So that's the people who are hiring. That's the people who are making the story decisions. Now, I think white people can make really good decisions about covering diverse communities. I really do. But you need more diversity at the table to be able to have a robust conversation about diversity and so that people don't feel as if they're isolated within the newsroom. All right, I'll give you one more exercise. How about that? When you're alone, there's a song, talk to one of your neighbors, I don't care which, and look at these questions, all right? Think about what it feels like when you're isolated or when you're different within a group. And it doesn't have to be you're a racial minority or a gender minority in a particular place. Again, just take a couple minutes to talk about it and ask some of these questions. What did it feel like? What happened? Were you heard or seen? What could you have done to advocate for yourself a little bit differently? All right, good. Come on.
I just thought, like, when you're alone, you're less likely to, like, make a presence of yourself, like, bring that attention because you feel secluded, like, you don't want to make yourself very known, I guess.
So it's hard to speak up because all eyes are on you. Okay, hat or stylus? Yeah, it's a lot of pressure. It's and you don't want to, and you always think that people are watching you, so you don't want to make a misstep because you accidentally say something wrong or what have you. Definitely, that's good. That's good. There was another hand back there. Yes. So they were trying to tease you and make you feel like you were welcome, but you didn't always feel welcome because that wasn't always the way you wanted to experience that. Is that right? Has anyone ever been, that's good, has anyone ever been in a situation where they haven't been heard because they're the only person there? I know I have. I mean, if I go to a bar, I mean, this is not a serious example, but if I go to a bar, I have to have Holly, who's taller than me, stand there and order because they don't see me. I'm, you know, a short, fat lesbian down here. No one's paying attention to me, but Holly's thankfully taller and more assertive. So, you know, she can get their attention and get me a drink. But it can also be a lot more serious, too, of course. I heard this great story from a friend of mine who covers the White House, and I think I have a picture. There we go. You know, during President Obama's first administration, maybe you guys have heard this too, because it was written about and I really like it. A lot of the women that were in meetings with him would say something, and then the men, I don't know if this has ever happened to you, the men would then represent mm-hmm. what the woman had said, and then the president would have heard the man and not the woman, right? So it's common, it happens, it's not the president doing that, it's just, it happens. And it's an unfortunate dynamic. So the women in the cabinet were really sick of it, and the young people in the cabinet were really, really sick of it. And so they all got together, and they said, all right, how are we going to fix this? Because he needs to hear us. He needs to be able to see what our vision is. And so what they did was they said if somebody was going to say something, then a woman or a young person would then speak up and say, well, Jane was saying this, and I really like her idea. And essentially, they were amplifying what that person was saying. And then there were other women in the room and other young people in the room who were doing the same. So the president eventually, I don't know if he caught on to the strategy. I think somebody said that he did. But essentially, he then started listening differently. Because it wasn't saying, I can't believe you're not listening to me, because that's not always effective, and you don't want to put anyone on the defensive. But it was essentially just all working together to make sure that the person who may not be always seen would be seen and heard by the president. They said towards the end of his administration, people felt not just empowered to be able to speak, but they were being heard. And in fact, there was a lot more gender diversity, a lot more racial diversity, and a lot more young people within his inner circle contributing to his administration, and he personally said it was something that really made him a better leader, and it made the administration better. So I don't know if this ever happens in one of your meetings, and you see somebody is not being heard. If you want to try this technique, I've tried it in my meetings, and it really does work. And people don't even know what's going on. It's just really trying to help somebody who's being overshadowed be heard a little bit differently. It will make them feel better, and it really does help make the team so much better. And it certainly helps in the newsroom. I'll go through this quickly. You know, women, of course, are also underrepresented in the newsroom. It's not just racial minorities. And it's a little shocking to me. But so this was a graphic I saw. For every 100 people in the newsroom, there are 2.2 black females in the newspaper industry. Like, how is that even possible in this day and age that there is such underrepresentation? Now, women have been in the newsroom for a lot longer. If any of you watch black and white movies, I'm sure you've seen some of these ladies. I love them, Lois Lane. You know, these were people I looked up to growing up because we watched a lot of old movies. So women have been in the newsroom since the 1800s. They kind of were shuffled off to do women's columns. Some, though, during World War II were great war correspondents. If you ever get a chance to read any of those biographies, they're amazing. They kind of slipped into some of the more serious roles, especially when the men were away at war. They also did these jobs where they would pretend to be somebody else and infiltrate an industry and be able to show from the inside what was going on. So women have a long, strong tradition of being in a newsroom. However, it's still kind of not right. So TV newsrooms, 58.4% are male, 41% female. And that has been the same thing for the last 22 years. That hasn't changed, even though I was reading that more women are actually in communication schools now than men. So we have a disproportionate number of women graduating from communication schools, but where are they going? Well, they're probably going to PR. So good for you guys who are going to PR. You have a much saner life, I hope. But it's really not encouraging to me that women aren't making it through to the newsroom because we need their voices as well, right? So look at newspapers. Women have only made up 36 to 38% of the newsroom, and that's starting, I guess, when they measured in 1998. Supervisors, 37% of supervisors are women. At least there are a number of newspapers that have women in the top position, but that doesn't always trickle down, and it doesn't always help. Radio, I was surprised by this, twice as many men in radio news as women. And of course, you know, if any of you watch the network news other than just old people like me, there are no females in those anchor chairs, right? There was for a minute, but that's it. So I think that says a lot about how much room there is to grow there, right? Also, in terms of stories, women only reported 32% of stories on network news. In terms of newspapers, they only had 37% of the bylines, and almost all the front page stories are reported by men. Again, there's nothing wrong with that, but if you're looking for a diversity of voices, if you're trying to reflect the community in a broader way, women and men do sometimes look at the world differently, right? And so wouldn't it be good to have a different representation on the front page? In terms of wires, so like AP and some of the things that newspapers now have to rely so much more on because their staff is so short, they only get 38% of the byline. So as wires become more important, this becomes a bigger issue for us. And in terms of the political shows on Sundays, if any of you guys watch those, men were guests 77% of the time. It's not that women don't like politics. It's not that women aren't authoritative voices on politics. I've talked to bookers on these shows and asked why that happens, and they said often men will volunteer. And when people reach out to women, sometimes they'll say, oh, there's somebody who's a better expert than me. So that's part of the problem too. So if anyone please ever asks you to speak, as somebody who has to book my own professional conferences, please say yes, please. I don't like public speaking, but I said yes because I think it's a feminist act for us to be able to do this, and I think it's really, really important. So one word of wisdom I thought was really good, Gloria Steinem's quote, I thought this was really interesting. It's hard to think of anything except air, food, and water that's more important than the media. It creates for us the idea of normal, whether or not normal is accurate, especially for groups that have been on the periphery for whatever reason. If we can't see it, we can't be it, which I think is a really important thing. All right, one more exercise. I have a couple more prizes. This is something that I think is really important. While we can all be advocates for people who are different from us, you know, we all come with our own baggage, right? We all come with our own biases. We all come with our own, you know, small understanding of some things in the world. So I want to do this exercise, all right? So when you see this guy, you can just call it out. What do you think of? You can just anything. What do you think of him? What? Breaking Bad. That's good. Do you think he's a respected person? Yes, sir. What, Jewish? Oh, interesting. I never thought about that. Okay. Anyone else? Because of the numbers, okay. Would you want to be alone in an alley with a guy like this? Yes, no?
No.
No, no. Scary, maybe a little scary? Okay, all right, remember that. What about this person? And if you know them, don't shout out who they are. What do you think of this person when you see her? Oh, it didn't change. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, there we go. What do you think of when you see her? Anyone? Nothing? Would you want to run into her in an alley? Would she be okay? Yeah? She looks nice, right? Friendly? Come on, anything? Oh, no. It's an old picture. Anyone else? Yeah, something, what, okay. Do you have a sense of maybe what her race would be or age or what do you think? 60s? Okay, all right, how about this one? What do you think of him when you see him? on, you got a word association. Just shout out anything. It doesn't matter. Businessman? Do you think he's trustworthy? They said, no, he's a businessman. Do you think, would you want to meet him in an alley? No? Oh, okay. Don't you? Anyone else? No? Yeah, I mean, does he look like somebody you would know, maybe? Politician? Okay. All right, what about this person? What do you think of this person? Coach? Did I hear coach? Okay. Anyone else? Speak up. It's okay. What'd you say? Nothing? Wait, would you trust this person? Yeah? Maybe. All right. Do you think, if you had to like dream up a job for what it is that he did, what would you think? This is a universal theme. Okay. All right. Okay. All right. So the first guy, remember the guy with the tattoos and the bald head? All right. So some of you said you wouldn't want to meet him in an alley. All right. So he's the mayor of a Pennsylvania town. He's this really cool guy. He has a master's from Harvard. All right. He ran a nonprofit that's totally transformed this town. He's revitalizing. He's doing a lot of work with the architecture in the neighborhood. And then the tattoos are a tribute to his people. One tattoo is his zip code. And then the other tattoo is for the people who've been murdered in his town. That's how dedicated he is to that. So he's the mayor. But we all kind of were a little apprehensive. Makes sense, right? Okay, this next person. Have you seen the Loving movie? This is that wonderful, wonderful woman, who Mildred Jeter, who is brave enough to be a part of Loving versus Virginia, you know, which is the Supreme Court case which allowed for interracial marriages to happen. Now, I didn't know this, but when I was reading about it, she actually never identified as African American, even though the police said she was and said terrible things to her. She actually is an American Indian. When we've shown this slide before, people usually, when we talk about race, we'll talk about African American. But she, looking at her documents, she's Cherokee and Rappahannock. So she actually wasn't African American, but was mistaken for such. But because of her, history changed and life is much, much better. Ted Bundy. A trustworthy businessman who murdered many, 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 many people. It's scary, but I was told that one of the reasons that he was so successful was because he looked like a trustworthy guy. You know, he had studied law, he was charming, allegedly, but he did hard. If you don't read about him and go to bed, okay? It's just horrifying what it is that he did. But again, we're kind of trained to trust a guy in a suit and tie and, you know, looks like somebody who might run for office. He might. This is Jameson Green. This is somebody I've interviewed quite a few times. This is a trans activist, an educator, somebody who's worked really hard on behalf of the trans community, who transitioned, I think like a decade ago, but has always been a really good advocate for a community that you know, is disproportionately murdered and suffers from hate crimes and everything else, is a really good activist on behalf of the community. I showed this, somebody showed us this exercise at a conference we went to this weekend, and it was interesting to me that we all kind of formed these ideas really pretty quickly about who folks were. We had ideas about their race, we had ideas about their age, you know, and we had some pretty quick ideas, even though we really had no idea who they were, and we trusted our instincts, right? So. First impressions, I work with a neurosurgeon, and so he talks a lot about what the brain does and what it's capable of. And first impressions, it takes just a tenth of a second for us to be able to form an impression of a stranger from their face. You know, back in the caveman days, that's a really good thing because you wanted to figure out if it was somebody who was going to eat you or hurt you, or if it was somebody who was going to be your friend. But your brain, you know, doesn't always behave in the way that it should, right? And so we have some unconscious or bias that has kept us safe back in the day, but may not always help now. We were told by one of these scientists that I was interviewing that 95% of our brain activity is beyond our actual control. So it's our subconscious, things that we learned growing up, things that we learned from church, things that we learned from our parents, telling us what's what, which is kind of amazing because, you know, you could be well-intentioned and really want to help people who are different from you, but your brain might not be helping you to make those decisions. So it's really good to know that we can at least be able to change, right? So we can, this was a story, this was a study about CEOs. So if you look at the population of tall people, 14% of American men are above 6 feet tall. 60% of CEOs are over 6 feet. So those of you who are tall, you're so very lucky. I'm sorry, Christine. The 40% of CEOs are over 6'2", and only 4% of the population is actually over 6'2". So it's not that we know that tall people are smarter than us or better than us, but there is something else going on there, right, that's interesting, that people seem to think that there is authority that comes with this height, right, which is kind of weird and kind of interesting and just a random fact, but it really, really helps, right? So I'm sure you've all seen this. This is a racism and resume study. So what they did was they took the names off of the top of resumes and gave them to people. They had equal qualifications, and people, you know, followed a specific pattern. When they put names that were typical in a particular community, so they had Jamal and then they had John, the people who were named Jamal didn't get an offer or didn't get an interview, right? So again, you may have well-intentioned hiring managers, but for some reason in their brains, they weren't thinking clearly about what it is that they were seeing. So it was just a name, even though the qualifications never changed, a name that changed people's opinion about whether or not somebody was actually qualified. I'm gonna end, I think, here. Because I know you probably, as a part of the millennial generation, you're part of the millennial generation, right, still, aren't you? Yeah. I'm sure you hear crap said about your generation all the time, right? People complain that millennials are lazy and they're entitled and all that other nonsense. I'm not one of those people. I always think that millennials are going to be our best and brightest future. I really think that looking at the demographic data, y'all have optimism, y'all are better about climate change, you're better about all sorts of diversity issues because you are more diverse and you volunteer more, you work pretty darn hard, right? So I think that when it comes to diversity, I hope that what you bring away from this, other than the four things that make for really good news stories, is that number one, it's really good to have a multiplicity of voices no matter where you go. And if you don't have that, if you're in one of those newsrooms that doesn't have any people of color, I want you to help people advocate for diversity of voices in the newsroom, please, 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 in any workplace. I also want you to help amplify the voices of those that aren't heard, because again, I know that your generation's really good at this kind of stuff, and I think you can teach my Generation Xers and the baby boomers how to do this better, right? Because I was listening to a talk from the dean about millennials who was suggesting that millennials are a lot like the grandparents, right? Or I guess it would be my grandparents. And my grandparents are part of that thing called the greatest generation, right? So I think you all have this opportunity to be the greatest generation. But I think in order to do that, you really should be thinking about these things. And please, 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 as a member of the media, I want you to think about how important it is for us to have a free press, how important it is for you to read widely, not just because you're qualifying for Scott Bridges' tests on current events, but really and truly think critically about what it is that's going on around you. You're going to hear a lot of propaganda. You're going to hear a lot of bias. But I think that the media can be your friend in this case, okay? So let me just end on this thing here. This is a guy from the Wall Street Journal, not the bastion of liberal thinking. He suggests that you need to look straight at things. You have to recognize and call them for what they are, nothing more or less. You have to see things as they are before we reinterpret them into what we'd like them to be. Believe in an epistemology that can distinguish between truth and falsity, facts and opinions, evidence and wishes. Defend habits of mind and institutions of society, above all, a free press, which preserve that epistemology. Hold fast to a set of intellectual standards and moral convictions that won't waver amid changes of political fashion or tides of unfavorable opinion. Speak the truth to power, as we say in journalism, irrespective of what it means for our popularity or for our influence. So please go forth, make this world a better place, and thank you so much for coming here tonight.